Welcome to Next Round with the Pacific Research Institute. I'm your host, Rowena Ichon. Next week is National School Choice Week, and to mark the week, PRI is launching Senior Director of Education Studies Lance Izumi's new book, Choosing Diversity: How Charter Schools Promote Diverse Learning Models and Meet the Diverse Needs of Parents and Children. Tim and I, PRI's Director of Communications, and I chat with Lance about his new book. One of the key characteristics that sets apart charter schools from regular public schools is the diversity of educational experiences charter schools offer. Lance profiles charter schools that are as diverse as you can imagine: urban schools, rural schools, schools for kids with special needs, even schools that promote tech, the arts, or America's heritage. All these charter schools are successfully graduating kids that go on to college, or if college isn't for them, find good jobs and become contributing members of our community. We think you'll enjoy this. Welcome to Next Round with the Pacific Research Institute, Lance.
It's great to be back on podcast with you, Ro, and with you, Tim.
Lance was one of our first guests when we started our podcast at PRI, and there was a time when we weren't quite sure what we were doing yet, and so we actually had to retape the entire podcast with Lance.
Well, I appreciate that. Now, I remember that last time, Ro, I had to give my Academy Award-winning performance twice.
Lance, we're so pleased to have you back on our podcast to talk about your exciting new book on charter schools called Choosing Diversity. Why don't you start by explaining to our listeners the premise for the book?
What I wanted to do in this book, which is a little different than a lot of my other books, is to talk about charter schools specifically, but not as a group of schools. So not looking at, let's say, large data pieces, how do charter schools perform as a group versus, let's say, regular public schools. What I really wanted to do was to show people who would read the book that within the charter school community, there is a huge variety of types of charter schools, which is why I chose the title of the book, Choosing Diversity, because not only do parents choose a charter school because it is a school of choice, they also choose from amongst a wide variety of schools. So they are actually choosing from diverse models of learning for their children, which again, underscores why we need school choice, because when we talk about meeting the individual needs of individual children, we are talking about having those types of schools that are able to meet those needs. And in order to do that, you have to have a wide variety of schools. And so that's what I do in this book. I look at 11 different charter schools, and each one of them comes with a different set of priorities, a different set of specialities, a different set of, strengths that are able to address the individual needs of these kids and the parents who want to send their children to them.
So Lance, in your book, you profile several different charter schools, and one of the most powerful, and we were both fortunate enough to get to visit out there, is called Life Learning Academy. And it's out on Treasure Island on San Francisco Bay. And it primarily serves homeless students at their campus. And we even made a mini documentary about the school called Welcome to Change. And our listeners can pretty soon check that out at pacificresearch.org. Why don't you share with our listeners what Life Learning Academy is all about and how it really exemplifies how charter schools are so important to meeting the diverse needs of students?
Well, thanks, Tim. Life Learning Academy, it's actually the very first school that I profile in the book. And I think it's really important because what it does is that it gives lie to the argument made by opponents of charter schools that charter schools are just creaming the best students from the regular public school system, which is why they, often do well, on performance measures. In the case of Life Learning Academy, you have just the opposite, really. You have a charter school, as you say, based on Treasure Island in San Francisco Bay, which caters to the really hardest to educate children who the regular public schools in San Francisco are not able to handle. These are kids who are long-term dropouts, kids who have been involved in the criminal justice system, kids who have come from homeless families and are living either on the streets or bouncing from couch to couch. In the words of Terry Delaney, who's the executive director there, these are the biggest pains that are out there. And, the school brings them in, gives them this incredible amount of love, and are able to give them a real great learning experience. And, that has resulted in, a graduation rate for these kids of over 90%, college going rate of probably 75% or more. And despite the fact that they are coming from very difficult and often violent backgrounds, there's not been a single fight in the 20 years that the school has been in existence.
One of the most poignant charter schools you profile is the New York City Autism Charter School, which is making a big difference in helping students with autism. Talk a little bit about this school and how charter schools can best serve students with disabilities.
Yeah, like Life Learning Academy, Ro, this school, New York City Autism Charter School, again, you know, underscores the fact that charter schools are able to address the needs not just of regular students who may just want a different experience, but the students with some of the greatest needs in our society. And the New York City Autism Charter School was started by two moms who simply wanted better education for their sons who had autism. And they looked around in the regular public school system in New York City and found that there were really no alternatives that satisfied them. And so therefore, they looked around some more and discovered charter schools and decided to actually start a charter school that addressed the needs of autistic children who are on the spectrum and who had all kinds of different issues that they had to cope with in order to learn. They started this charter school, and the school has proved to be incredibly effective and popular. It focuses on changing the behavior of children with autism through a technique that they call applied behavior analysis, which encourages positive behavior and discourages negative behavior. And this is really important because one of the problems that children with autism have is that their behavior in certain social and other types of circumstances get in the way of them being able to learn, and unless their behavior is able to change in a positive way, they are not able to learn. And so this school has been very adept in being able to do that. It often takes, you know, months to change even basic types of behavior, but they are very successful at doing that. And the school collects data on how the students behave and then involves teachers and parents in developing strategies to address these issues. And again, you know, you end up with students who would ordinarily basically be kicked to the side, but who are now able to learn and are able to participate in society. For example, the school has a very terrific internship program where they place their students in businesses anywhere from Facebook to White Castle. And so it's something that gives hope to both the students and the parents, and you know, really is something that is very unique when it comes to education.
The thing that struck me most about this charter school was a scene when a teacher was trying to help a student learn to communicate with others. It just illustrated to me the tremendous challenge of educating kids with autism. The other issue I wanted to bring out was the cost of educating these special needs kids. You mentioned approximately $80,000 a year. Given that, you know, these students grow up to be independent adults and they'll need less government assistance, I think this upfront investment seems worthwhile.
Well, I think that's absolutely right. Let me first address what you first mentioned about those kids who are able to engage in regular social interaction, which is, you know, we take for granted, but which is, you know, for them a real achievement. And what you're talking about is that those kids are being taught what's called perspectives taking. And under perspectives taking, they have to be able to understand that the focus is not only on them and what they want to get across, what their interest is, but they have to understand that in a conversation or interactions in a social setting with other students or with adults or with teachers, that they have to take the perspective of the other person. And just being able to teach those students with autism that that's what they need to do in order to have good social interactions with people is a huge achievement. And it often does take months for that to occur. But when it does, and you look at the result, those kids are being able to interact in a way that is positive and allows them to be able to participate in the wider society, as, you know, for example, these internship programs that I mentioned indicate. To go back then to your issue about the cost of the education, yes, it does cost, as you mentioned, upwards of $80,000 per student. There is a very low student-teacher ratio there. They're able to give a lot of one-on-one instruction to the kids. But I think what's important to understand is to look at that cost figure not in isolation, because when you look at the cost of putting these children, let's say, in a private school setting, which is often what regular school systems do, is that when they have kids who have severe autistic problems, that they are often put, you know, these private schools in order to address their needs, that it's actually much less expensive, significantly less expensive, to have them in this charter school setting with that price tag than to have them in another setting. And also, too, as you mentioned, the cost eventually to society in terms of having these kids being able to participate participate in the workplace, being able to fend for themselves as opposed to constantly need government assistance is a huge cost long term. So, you know, it's really, when you look at it and think about it that way, a less expensive and cost efficient way to deal with the problems and the education for these kids who are on the autistic spectrum.
Lance, charter schools can also play an important role, as we know, in helping to prepare students to get a good career, really pursue whatever their career dreams are. So I know two of the schools that you profile in the book, Design Tech High School and Summit Shasta Public School, are focused on preparing kids for careers in the tech world. So can you talk a little bit about these schools and how their learning models are setting kids up to succeed in the tech economy of the future?
Well, Design Tech High School is located in Redwood City, and it's located on the business campus of the Oracle Corporation, which is one of the big Silicon Valley giants. And it's the only school in California that is located on a corporate campus. And so each student there, as you mentioned, it's a high-tech oriented type of school. So each student gets their own personal Chromebook, and they use that instead of textbooks, and the Chromebook has an online management system that allows teachers to review student data and to personalize instruction for each one of those students. But it's not just the use of computer hardware and education software. Design Tech is called Design Tech because they have a learning method called design thinking, which involves understanding the needs of consumers, engineering and creating solutions, and then also teaching entrepreneurship to the students so that they can disseminate their vision through the wider society. And, you know, in my study of Design Tech, I talked to students and teachers there, and one of the students there, a girl named Mia, told me that when she took her design thinking courses, it really changed the way she thought about the world, and it created something for her. It was all about creating something that she was passionate about, and thinking about how the user, though, would be able to use it, and therefore being able to have to turn her passion into something practical for the user. Another girl, Kara, who I talked with, said that design thinking is really centered around the concept of empathy. Instead of being prompted with a problem, she says that at that school, students have to figure out what's the issue in the community, how are you going to address that issue, and how are you going to provide a solution that actually meets the practical needs of individuals within that community. She says that what she's learned is that she needs to understand what users want and combine it into something, again, that she's passionate about creating. So when we talk about tech economy, it's also not just, again, about computers. It's also about how students think about the world and about their fellow community members. And with regard to Summit Public Charter Schools, which is a charter school network, has a lot of charter schools here in California and in other states, they, again, also use an online learning platform, and students, like at Design Tech, are issued Chromebooks. And, you know, once students there have mastered the material, they're assessed online, and the assessments are graded instantly by the computer. The online platform there allows the students to set their goals, track their progress, and direct their own learning by accessing resources that make up the Summit curriculum. Students proceed at their own pace, and they set their own goals and track their own progress. I interviewed Helen, a student over there, who said that she completed her online playlist of materials and assignments by December of the school year, so she was able to work ahead in all her classes. I think that what you see there is the ability of this tech education to be able to give flexibility to students to be able to work up to their competence, not merely according to some artificial timeline.
Charter schools are also fueling the interest of students pursuing the arts. You profile a charter school outside of Sacramento, Natomas Charter School, which has an incredible program for students interested in music, theater arts, and visual arts. I think if I had to do it all over again, I would choose the Natomas Performing Arts School as my place to attend high school. Let's talk about the various programs provided by this charter school and how charter schools in general can help fuel the passion of students with great talents.
Well, that's right. You know, I'll tell you this. At Natomas Charter School, which is one of the early charter schools that was started here in California back in the early 1990s, it's actually an interesting school for many reasons. One of the is that there are actually five different academies that operate under the umbrella of Natomas Charter School, one of which is their Performing and Fine Arts Academy, which is, you know, where you have students who are interested in music, dance, the performing arts, and the visual arts. And so I've been to actually several performances by students there. You know, I've gone to plays, Hairspray. I just went to see their performance of Oklahoma. And I am telling you that, you know, when you go to a high school performance, you think, okay, you know, hopefully it'll be okay. And, you know, you won't cringe. But when you go to Natomas Charter School and to their performing fine arts performances, you are just struck by the high level of professionalism and talent of these students. And really, it's when I watch their performances, it's better than many, you know, performances where I've had to pay for a professional company to see a play. And so at these at this school, I think it gives students this opportunity to be able to take their core classes, to be able to take college prep classes, but also in a setting that allows them to take advantage and to be able to fulfill their creative possibilities. I talked to a student named Allie who was a visual arts person, and she really came alive when she started to be taught all the various aspects of painting. She went from painting cubism to painting pop art style, and she just, and it opened up an entire new chapter for her in her life because of this. And she would never have been able to do that had she not been able to go to a school like this, because as we know, in many regular public schools, the arts and music departments are being cut, whereas, you know, here we have a school which actually focuses on the arts, and that should be made available to students who want to take advantage of that.
Lance, as you discussed a little bit earlier, you know, a common myth of charter schools is that they really just weed out the best of the bunch. They only choose the best students. Well, we know that that's not the case, and especially for charter schools in urban communities, you know, they simply just don't have that luxury. They're often located in very dangerous parts of the city, and they have student populations that are facing all sorts of challenges like gang pressures and violence and other real-life challenges. So you profiled two charter schools, a Magnolia in Los Angeles and the legendary Success Academy in New York, that have succeeded in educating these kids. So talk about the learning models of these schools and why they've succeeded in these communities where traditional public schools have failed.
When you look at something like Success Academy in New York City, you know, you're really struck by the fact that here they have a student population which is, you know, very high levels of poor students, mostly minority students, and yet, you know, when you look at the rankings in New York State, the Success Academy schools, and I think there are about 47 of these schools across New York State, that 13, I think, out of the top 20 schools in New York are actually Success Academy schools. And so, you know, you're really struck by the ability of this school to be able to succeed, you know, where regular public schools have failed. And, you know, if you look at their learning models, you know, they're both Success Academy and the Magnolia charter schools, which are in Los Angeles and Southern California, both use a lot of project-based learning models where, you know, students do a lot of hands-on work. But in order to learn the basics, in order to be able to perform at high levels, and so it's not just playing around with things, it's being able to use projects in order to be able to learn the fundamentals that these kids are going to need in order to progress in their education. And I think that one of the things also that you see in schools like Success Academy is that they are able to create an environment for these kids that where they're able to learn, because a lot of the kids from these backgrounds often come from, you know, dysfunctional backgrounds. And so what the Success Academy strives to do is to create a learning environment, an atmosphere of stability for these children so that they are able to learn, that they won't be distracted by disruptions that go on in the classroom in so many other regular public school classrooms, especially in places like New York City. And so I know that unfortunately there's been a lot of misreporting about the discipline policies actually at Success Academy, for example. And yet, you know, when you look at their attrition rate, their attrition rate is actually much, much less than at the regular public schools, which, you know, goes to show that parents and students support, you know, a tough love style of of learning where there are consequences to behavioral problems. And so once those are understood, you know, children are able to then, you know, focus on the learning, which is really what they're there for. And I think the combination of teaching and instructional methods based on this project-based learning method and also the stable learning environment, I think has added up to the success that you see at Success Academy, and also to the fact that in areas, for example, in science, Success Academy and the Magnolia Charter Schools both have partnered with museums, and like in the case of Magnolia, with the Mount Wilson Observatory in Los Angeles, that they're able to really give kids that hands-on experience that really does ignite their curiosity and interest in, for example, the STEM subjects. So it's a very heartening experience to look at these schools and to see what they're doing with these kids that in the regular public schools are having so many problems.
It's not talked about much, but public schools in rural communities are generally not making the grade. Not only is funding a challenge, but it's tough for them to attract quality teachers and even assure a safe learning environment. You profile a school near Bakersfield, Grimway Academy, which is making a real difference in a poor rural community. Talk about this school and how charter schools can bring equal educational opportunities for kids in rural communities.
Yeah, that's an important question, Ro. Rural areas, unfortunately, are often, you know, the part of the country that gets left out in the discussion about charter schools, because I think a lot of people, to the extent that they know charter schools, often think about charters that are based in urban areas, in, you know, some tough inner cities, you know, whether it's in Oakland or Detroit or Los Angeles or wherever. But there are rural charter schools, but there's also a great need for more charter schools in rural areas, because if you're thinking about addressing the needs of low-income students, students from minority backgrounds, well, a lot of those students live in rural areas, and which is why I profile the Grimway Academy Charter School, which is based in Shafter, which is in Kern County. And for those who don't know California geography, Kern County is located just north of Los Angeles County, but you know, it may be an hour or two away from LA, but it's a world away when you look at, you know, what is out there. It's a very agricultural community, and the Grimway Academy was started by Barbara Grimm Marshall, who is the owner of Grimway Enterprises, Grimway Farms, the largest carrot producers and harvesters in the country. She saw the need for better schools, more school alternatives for the low-income minority students who are in her community, and established first a charter school in the little town of Arvin, and then has just started up this second charter school in Shafter. I've visited there several times, and the school has done an incredible amount of good for the kids there. I mean, one of the things that I found first off when I talked to the children at the Grimway Academy at the Shafter campus was that they were simply grateful that Grimway was offering them a safe atmosphere in which to learn. Talked with one little boy who was telling me that at his previous school, there was a shooting at the school which totally not only frightened him, but really had made a lasting imprint on his ability to learn, because he was always afraid of his safety at that school. And now that he's in a safe environment at Grimway, he has been able to focus on his studies and do what he should be doing. You know, that school offers, you know, things that, you know, you would not necessarily expect maybe in a rural school. It's very high-tech oriented. The use of high-tech in the classroom is not just something that's limited to a school like Design Tech or Summit in the Bay Area, in the Silicon Valley. At Grimway Academy in Shafter, they use a blended learning model where students spend a lot of time in a learning lab, and they are using computers and educational software and using different types of instructional methodologies in order to address their weaknesses. And that's proved to be very effective. Those students have performed very well on various performance and achievement measures. And so, you know, what you're seeing with these kids is that Grimway Academy, a charter school in a rural area, is offering them the choice that most kids, unfortunately, in rural areas do not get, and that they're able to not only be safe, but also to learn, and then also to be able to go on and be successful after school.
So, Lance, finally, you know, charter schools can also help parents who are concerned that traditional public schools just may not reflect their values. And in your book, you profile an excellent charter school just north of Sacramento, John Adams Academy, which has a classical education focus. And coincidentally for our listeners, we're having an event on your book there on January 22nd. And for our listeners who are interested in attending, attending, you can go on and register on our website at pacificresearch.org. For those who can attend, talk about how charters like John Adams Academy can serve the needs of parents who are looking for values-based educational options.
Well, I think that's a really important point, Tim. John Adams Academy is located in the community of Roseville. At least there are three campuses, but the campus that you and I visited was in Roseville, which is just north of Sacramento. And that area has regular public schools that, you know, most people might, if you look at, your usual performance indicators, may think are quote-unquote good schools. And so, therefore, you might wonder, why is it that, parents might want an alternative to so-called good schools? And so when the founders of John Adams Academy first posted a meeting notice that they were thinking about creating this school based upon principles of the American founding and America's heritage, they felt that, maybe if they got a dozen people to show up at the first informational meeting, that would be great. Instead, what they got was they got hundreds of people who showed up at that informational meeting. In fact, the line of cars that were trying to get into the parking lot for that informational meeting was so long that the police had to be called and to find out what the heck is going on and why, is this line of cars spreading down the street and into the highway. And so, what that shows was there was a great demand, not just, for a school that was going to give good academics, but also a school that was also going to be promoting, a certain type of value. In this case, as you say, heritage, American heritage values. In fact, when I went to first visited the school, I was struck by the fact that before class every day, students will come outside of their school building, and there are several school buildings around the campus, but they'll come outside of their particular school building, and there's an American flagpole there, and they would all sing a patriotic song in front of the flag. And how many times do you see that anymore? I mean, in the case of the song that I saw the kids perform when I was there, they were singing Home on the Range, and I hadn't seen that song performed in ages.
Now, Lance, did you sing along at the flagpole?
Now, I must admit that I am a huge fan of patriotic songs, and so I actually had a teacher back when I was in the sixth grade who taught us all kinds of patriotic songs, and I remembered all the words. And so, yes, I must say that I did sing along with those kids as they were singing Home on the Range, and it just actually filled my heart with a lot of happiness that there are kids who are learning about not just principles of freedom that our founding fathers laid down, but also too the heritage of this country, which includes the musical history of patriotism as well. And so what students here at John Adams Academy, not only do they sing patriotic songs in front of a flag, but they also, once they get into class, what they do have, they have a classical learning education model, and it's based upon the great ideas and the great works that have shaped Western civilization, in all the major disciplines, from both English, mathematics, the arts. And so students read these great classic works that promote principles of liberty and virtue, morality, entrepreneurship, and democracy. And they read the great authors, such as in the 10th grade, for example, students are going to read Sir Walter Scott, Dante, Shakespeare, Milton, Jane Austen, Tocqueville, Martin Luther, Machiavelli, Thomas Paine, Edmund Burke, and John Locke, just to name a few. And so the fact that these kids are learning from original primary sources, as opposed to reading through the filter of some other author's interpretation of these works, I think is really important for those kids to therefore understand what those authors, what those great men and women were really thinking of when they were writing their works, and then to glean the ideas that they were promoting, and then to be able to discuss those ideas in a classroom where the class is taught in a Socratic method, where there's a huge give and take between the teacher and the student, and so it's just not memorizing and regurgitating material. You have a real repartee between student and teacher, and there's a real great exchange of ideas. In fact, I was watching one classroom where a student was actually correcting his teacher on what the proper role of the Greek god Apollo was in the pantheon of the Greek gods. And so the teacher actually then admitted, well, actually, you're right, that your description of what Apollo represented and what he was responsible for, it was more accurate than what the teacher laid out. So I think that's the kind of thinking that is promoted in John Adams Academy. And, when I was there, this, and I'll end with this, is that I was there on Veterans Day, or at least at a Veterans Day ceremony, and I was asked to give a speech there. And I will tell you that I have never seen a better Veterans Day ceremony, celebration than was put on at John Adams Academy. The level of understanding that the student speakers had for why we need to honor our veterans, why the sacrifices that they had to commit in order to protect this country was simply amazing. And, you know, that was not something that was simply scripted, and that came from their hearts. And that's the product of the education at a place like John Adams Academy. And it really, truly gave me hope for the future of this country.
Lance, you're not a consumer of adult beverages, but you always have a great non-alcoholic drink recommendation for our listeners. What are you drinking these days to celebrate the release of your new book and mini documentary?
Well, Ro, you know, a week or so ago, I actually had to give a speech up in the Napa Valley. At my speech, I actually talked a bit about my upcoming book, Choosing Diversity, and the accompanying film on that focuses on Life Learning Academy. So after my speech was finished, and the speech went over very well, I thought, okay, I deserve something after that. And so as I was driving back down Highway 29, I thought, you know something, I'm going to stop and have my favorite beverage. And I did not stop at a winery. I actually stopped at the A&W root beer stand and had a root beer float. And so that was my reward to myself for that speech. And my recommendation for anybody out there who wants a good drink and a good reward is to have a root beer float.
You can have one hard or in the traditional non-alcoholic way.
Thanks so much, Lance.
Thank you, Ro, and thanks, Tim.
For Tim and I and Lance Izumi, thanks for listening. Here's a few announcements. If you're in the San Francisco area, mark your calendars for a luncheon with Steve Moore on January 24th. Later in the spring, March 23rd, Tucker Carlson will be our keynote speaker at our 40th anniversary gala in San Francisco. Details for both events are on the website at pacificresearch.org. If you like this episode, please tell your friends to subscribe to PRI's podcast at iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, or TuneIn, and please do us a favor and give us 5 stars. You can also listen to our podcast on PRI's YouTube page, youtube.com/PacificResearch1. That's the number one. Thanks for listening. I'm Rowena Itchon. We hope you'll come back again for next round with PRI.